Penguin Random House Audio presents An Extravagant Life, an autobiography incorporating Blue Water, Green Skipper by Stuart Woods, read for you by Tony Roberts. In loving memory of my mother, Dot, who gave me not just my life, but my life as a writer, I miss her every day. The Laundering of Slightly Soiled Linens. 1. In the late 1920s in Detroit, Michigan, a 19-year-old youth stood in court and, having been convicted of the crime of stealing 16 cars, faced a judge for sentencing. His name was Stuart Franklin Lee, and he had been in trouble for several years. He was born in Atlanta, Georgia, in 1907, to one Arthur Lee, son of a prosperous builder, and Annie Lee Jones, who had led a hard life. Arthur Lee had served as his illiterate father's bookkeeper, secretary, and assistant in his successful construction business, but when his father died, Arthur Lee was unable to hold the company together. He moved his family north to Detroit, where he found work as a circulation manager for a large newspaper, a somewhat inflated title since it meant that he was in charge of filling and collecting coins from a string of newspaper vending machines. Arthur began to drink. Annie Lee Jones, a farmer's daughter, had been orphaned at the age of 6 and, with her younger brother, Willie, sent to a children's home where little Willie later died in her arms, apparently of institutional neglect. Annie Lee's fortunes took a turn for the better when she was adopted by a St. Louis family named Chevalier. Their Missouri neighbors had apparently been unable to handle the French pronunciation of their name, so they pronounced it Chevalier. The adoption was not an entirely altruistic one. Annie Lee was put to work in the Chevalier household, and although she was treated kindly, especially by her adopted older brother, Stuart, she was little more than a servant. Annie Lee and Arthur had 3 sons, Oree, Stuart, and Brown, and a daughter, Palestine, called Pal. Although raised in a strict Baptist household by their mother, their father was not much of an example, and the boys became wild in their teens. They got away with vandalism, but soon they turned to joyriding in stolen cars. As a result, Stuart spent some time in a reformatory, where he managed to get himself charged with assault with intent to kill, for hitting a guard who called him a filthy name. The charges were later dropped. After his release, he turned to car theft and eventually tried to pull off an armed robbery. Finally, Stuart was arrested, charged, and jailed. While awaiting trial, he escaped from custody and was recaptured. The family rallied around him, concocting an alibi that he had been at home on the evening of the crime, playing pinochle. The defense called his parents, brothers, and sister to the stand, and each of them related the alibi. Then, when the prosecutor confronted Stuart with evidence that they had lied and threatened to charge the whole family with perjury, Stuart changed his plea to guilty. At his trial, when asked by the judge if he had anything to say for himself, Stuart replied, "A man's got to have a car." Not amused, the judge sentenced him to 15 years in the Michigan State Penitentiary. His uncle, Stuart Chevalier, meanwhile, had become a prominent attorney in New York and Washington, specializing in tax law. Stricken with polio at the age of 4, he walked on crutches, and as a young man, he was told by his physicians that he had only a short time to live. His reaction was to write a reflective book, A Window on Broadway, offering advice to young men on living a responsible life, advice his nephews did not follow. He wrote much of the early federal income tax code and taught law at Washington and Lee University. When his friend and fellow polio victim, Franklin Roosevelt, started a polio treatment center in Warm Springs, Georgia, and built a house there, Chevalier built a house next door and was treated in the waters from the hot springs. He married a beautiful and capable young woman named Elizabeth Pickett, a novelist and screenwriter who wrote the screenplay for the first full-length Technicolor motion picture, Redskin, starring Richard Dix, and whose novel, Drivin' Woman, a southern saga in the mold of Gone with the Wind, was number 3 on the first ever New York Times bestseller list in 1942, and achieved a higher price from the movies than had Miss Mitchell's book. The film was shelved because of the advent of World War II and was never made. The law firm that Chevalier co-founded in Washington, D.C., Miller, Chevalier, Peeler, and Wilson, survives today as Miller and Chevalier. With her son in prison, Annie Lee sought the help of her adopted brother, and Chevalier, in one way or another, managed to get the boy released after serving 7 years. Since he had not impressed the Michigan authorities with his respect for the law, a condition of his release was that he take up residence in another state. Stuart's sister, Pal, married a Detroit policeman, Garrel Noah, and settled down to raise a family in that city, but Stuart Chevalier, mindful that his namesake was persona non grata in Michigan, moved the Lee family to Warm Springs, where he bought them a small farm. Since none of the Lees were farmers by experience or inclination, this was not a happy time for the family. But Stuart got a job at Roosevelt's Polio Treatment Center, later called the Georgia Warm Springs Foundation. He worked as a pushboy, a position unique to that institution. A pushboy's duties consisted entirely of pushing patients in their wheelchairs or on tables to their surgeries, treatments, and meals. It wasn't much, but Stuart Lee was a free man. Whether his prison experience had changed him is hard to say, but it cannot have been easy for him. These were rough years in the penal system, and the Michigan authorities were not noted for being leaders in prison reform. Still, Stuart's reputation among his youthful peers in his new town was one of being handsome, charming, and an all-around good fellow who boxed as an amateur in local bouts. Soon he met a young woman from nearby Manchester who, a gifted pianist, was often asked to play as entertainment for the Warm Springs patients, and they fell in love. Her name was Dorothy Calloway, called Dot by all who knew her. 2. The Calloways were an old pioneer family in Meriwether County. The first of their ancestors in America, one Sir Thomas Calloway, a Cornish man, had received a king's grant of land in Kentucky and had arrived in the New World in 1688. His son, Colonel Richard Calloway, was a friend of Daniel Boone, who rescued Calloway's kidnapped daughters from the Indians, as related in the novel The Last of the Mohicans by James Fenimore Cooper. Some of the family radiated south, one branch to Meriwether County, another to LaGrange in Troop County, where Fuller Calloway founded Calloway Mills. In 1909, Fuller Calloway founded a new town in Meriwether County at the spot where Georgia's Highway 41 crossed the Birmingham Southern Railroad. The railroad would site the repair shops for their engines in the new town, becoming an important employer. But Calloway would build a cotton mill, which would become the town's major employer for more than half a century. He called his new town Manchester, after the English textile center. Incidentally, there is a Manchester in each of the contiguous 48 states, except Rhode Island. This is the sort of thing one learned in the Manchester public schools. Calloway bought some of the land where the mill and the workers' houses would be built from William Henry Calloway, a distant cousin who was a farmer, landowner, and a lay Baptist preacher in the county. W.H. Calloway had two sons, W.H. Jr., called Will Henry, and Tom. With the money from the sale of land to his kinsmen, W.H. created farms for his two sons, and built a comfortable house on each. The brothers settled down, married sisters, Carrie and Lester Fowler, thereby making their respective children double first cousins, and farmed cotton. In the late 19-teens, the boll weevil swept through the county, ruining most of the cotton farmers. Tom, regarded as the less responsible of the brothers, got a job on the railroad and managed to hold on to his property, though he never seriously farmed it again. Ironically, Will Henry, who was regarded as hard.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.